Amen. Hearts on fire. Well, good evening, everybody. Welcome to the house of our God. You know, it was just this time last week that we were saying a prayer and walking out the door. We had no power, so I'm glad you came back. It was like 7 o'clock, and Brother Keith and I were in the church. It was like, nobody here. It's like, I wonder if they're coming back. So God bless you. You have endured the rain. There's a special blessing on you tonight. You know that, right? Special, special blessing for coming out in the rain. So, well, God bless. You know, we're in our series here, and we're doing the Good Father. And the topic tonight, we're doing the one that we handed out last week. The topic tonight is through the year. It's not a specific feast. We're in between feasts right now. And it's a good time, I think, to catch up and reflect and maybe look at, you know, as we've studied these feasts and God has revealed himself to us, how these things affect our lives, how it changes us, how it impacts us. And I do believe that with all of these truths that God gives us, it changes the way we live our lives, you know, it changes the way we think, and it changes the way we live, you know. So many times I say it all the time, you might not be able to leave the service. Like, you ever have someone ask you, you know, what did the preacher preach about? And sometimes you just draw a blank. I don't know, but I tell you, it was good, man. Can't remember one thing, but it was good. That's allowed. That's allowed, because sometimes you can't remember the words that were said, but the Word of God's alive. It changes us. Yeah. You know, just sitting, hearing that word, it changes us. So the Word never returns void, right? It does accomplish what it was sent to accomplish. So be encouraged by that when you forget everything that I'm about to say tonight, okay? Because it sure does encourage me. All right, so. Well, if you look in your notes there, the subtitle through the year is Divine Freedom from Anxiety. As we study God and who we are and so on and so forth, I think one of the greatest things that God can do for us is to deliver us from fear. Deliver us from fear. And some of us might be bold enough or arrogant enough or deceived enough to say in our lives, well, I'm not afraid of anything. Oh, that's not really true. Even the biggest, baddest, most macho men of them all are afraid of something. You know, and God came to deliver us from a fear, an anxiety, sometimes just an anxiety of heart and apprehension. You know, so many times we talk about it, so many times the days go by and you're just anxious of heart. You don't even know why, you know, like, why am I so anxious today? Yeah, right? Anyone ever experienced that stuff? And then you search and say, I have to be anxious for a reason, right? Why am I so anxious? And you'll find something, right? But God's going to deliver us from this. So with our text tonight, let us read from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 12. Let us read the parable of the rich fool, okay? Verses 13 through 21. And Pastor Dad, if you'll start the reading for us.
Then one of the crowd said to him, Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me. But he said to him, Man, who made me a judge and arbitrator for you? And then he said to them, Take heed, beware of greed. For one's life does not consist of the abundance of things he possesses.
Then he spoke a parable to them, saying, The ground of a certain man yielded plentifully. And he thought within himself, saying, What shall I do, since I have no room to store my crops? So he said, I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build greater, and there I will store all my crops and all my goods.
And I will say to my soul, Soul, you have many goods laid up for many years. Take your ease, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, Fool, this night your soul will be required of you. Then whose will those things be which you have provided? So is he who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God.
Excellent. Thank you. Most of us are familiar with these passages here. And I really especially like that section that you read there, Sister Trick. You know, you get to a point in life, perhaps, and you say, I've stored up enough. Let's eat, drink, and be merry. And God's immediate response to that is, Fool, you fool. You know, and he goes on to say, the riches of this life is not what gives us comfort or peace, right? It's the riches in God that gives us peace. So this is a great, great passage. I love this passage. And it's the parable of the rich fool, and where we are told in this parable to beware of greed, beware of covetousness, or a modern day word is beware of greed. So with this, Roman numeral number one, it says that, well, before we get to Roman numeral number one, there's two sentences prior to that. Let us read that together. It says this. It says, in his own way, this man, this rich young man, does what everyone is urged to do nowadays. That is, to look ahead, to make provision for his old age, to arrange for all kinds of pensions and insurances. And very true, isn't it? That's exactly what we are encouraged to do today. This rich young ruler was rebuked, called a fool, for doing what we think is the wisest of things to do. So let it forever change the way we think in a certain way, if you will. You know, and it's so true. How many of us, not by a raise of hands, always are thinking of our future and how to prepare for our future? You think of Social Security, some of us. And then sometimes when you get close to it, you say, I don't think there's going to be enough Social Security for me. And some of you who aren't ready for Social Security, you say, gee, I wonder if it's even going to be there when it's time for me to draw, right? What am I going to live off of? And you think, and you have, I don't know what you might have, but you might have a 401k or some kind of insurance or investment, and you say, how am I going to live in my old age? And we spend so much time. A lot of times our work is not just a matter of taking care of the rent and food today. We also, some of us, by and large, we want to see that we have enough food, enough money to retire on. And we see here that that's not really the thinking that's encouraged or even admired in the Bible. As a matter of fact, this rich young ruler was rebuked for taking care in it, thinking that his future security would come from a certain amount of money that he would amass. And when we think that our future security rests in what we can amass, when we don't have that, we are left with anxiety, right? And perhaps even the chiding of our fellow family members and friends. You haven't planned for the future. You don't have money for the future. You haven't planned for a rainy day. Listen, I'm just barely getting by. No, I have not planned for a rainy day. It rains every day as far as I'm concerned. It's raining today. I'm not worried about tomorrow's rain. There's a flood out there today. So be encouraged that this is not Bible thinking anyway. Great, so far I love it. Okay, let us look. Roman numeral number one, it says here, it says, do not trust in riches. Do not trust in riches, rather, what does it say? As a matter of fact, you take out the dollar bill. What does the dollar bill say? It says, I believe, in God we trust. Oh my goodness, how did that get on the dollar bill? In God we trust. Oh man, we need that reminder every day. And thank God it's also written on the $1 bill, because that's usually what we have in our pockets, you know. In God we trust. In God we trust. Because finances, my goodness. You know, look at that first line there. It says, a person's life consists not, or rather, our happiness and comfort depends not on our riches. Our happiness and comfort depends not on our riches. Does anyone want to give me an amen on that one? Because it's the truth, whether we believe it or not. It's the truth. And God, even in regard to planning for your old age, God says this, don't trust in riches, man. God is your provider. He will provide for you in your old age. Can someone say thank you, Jesus, for that? He will provide for you in your old age as much as you provide for you in any period of your life. God will provide for you.
Amen.
Amen. And to think that you could amass a certain amount of wealth to get you through your retired years is a foolish thought anyway, because God says, do not trust in riches. Your riches could disappear in a moment. Your trust should never be in riches, as if I put enough away for my retirement, I'm now comfortable. Really, God says, you fool. You fool. Those riches could disappear in a moment. Our faith and our trust is not in our riches. Whether you have it for tomorrow or you don't have it for tomorrow, your trust is in God and God alone. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. This is the way of the world, but it's not the way of God to trust in riches that we've amassed for our retirement. Amazing. I just think it's really amazing. So with this, our trust is never in riches. It's never in riches. And sometimes we think, oh, if I just get this, I just get that, I'll be happy. Happiness is not dependent upon that. So we will reevaluate. Roman numeral number two, I'd like us to look at that. The title of Roman numeral 2 is bigger bonds, but really the proper word is greater, because in verse 18 it says, so he said, I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build greater. Build greater. And there I will store up all my crops and my goods. I will say to my soul, soul, you have many goods laid up for many years. Then I will be at ease, eat, drink, and be merry. One little verse. It says, I will about 4 or 5 times. It says, my about, it's all about me, 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 and me. Do I have enough money for me? Do I have enough provision for me? Am I okay today? And am I okay tomorrow? All about me. And this is really what's being rebuked here. To think about life only in terms of yourself. I will store up treasures for myself. And the interesting aspect here is, he later and goes on and says, I will tear down my barns and I will build greater ones, because the earth produced a certain amount of crops, as if it was his doing, as if he produced the crops, as if he made himself rich. Ha, ha. Anybody in life who ever thinks they have made their self rich, the answer is, ha. Huh. The only one who is rich in this life is those who God says will be rich in this life. It is not through your hard work. No, it isn't. It is not through your due diligence. It is not because of your Aunt May that left you $1 million. I wish I had an Aunt May. I really wish I had an Aunt May. And you know, even the lie of it that we tell each other and beat each other up with it, the hard work, you've earned this through hard work. You and I know plenty of hardworking people who are poorer than dirt. Hard work does not make you rich. What makes you rich? God determines.
That's right.
Who will have and who will not have this, that, or the other thing. God determines it. Yes, he does. He says, my ground has produced this. God produced it. Everything comes from God. And as we go through this life, whether it's finances or anything else that you seem to be rich in regard to, whether you're a person who has joy or a person who has strength or a person who has patience or whatever your gift is in life, there's a million gifts in life. Whatever your gift is in life, some people have a propensity to book knowledge. You know, some people are just brilliant Einsteins, right? That's a gift from God too. It's not because they went to school for 20 years. I mean, that adds to, or opens up rather, what God has given them. But there are Einsteins in life because God picks them. I'm sorry, that's the way it works. God says, you're gonna be an Einstein and you're not gonna be an Einstein. He says, you're gonna be rich and you won't be rich. But everybody is rich in some way. You ever think about some of these scientists and these guys that are able to put people upon the moon and build these computers? And these are God-given brains. Look at Einstein himself. Einstein flunked out of high school. His teacher said he would amount to nothing. This was Einstein, because his wisdom was given to him by God. God chose him to be wise. And any time in life, whatever gift you might have in life, whatever strength you might have in life, some people are very good at sports, some people are very good at dance, some people are very good at math, some people are very good at music. I don't know what you're good at, but you're good at something, right? Everybody in this room is good at something. Some people are talented musicians, some people, you don't want them to sing next to you during service. That's just the way it is. But everybody has a gift. To think that your gift came from your effort is the lie.
That's right.
Good. The gift that you have was given by God for the sake of all.
That's right.
Whether you're good in math or music or dance, you can go to dance classes, but it's God that gave you the gift. You can go to school for 20 years, but it's still God that gave you the brain.
That's right.
Anytime you take credit for your gift, that is the rich fool who says, I will build greater bonds. Any time that you think that you are greater than somebody else because of something that you have is the rich young fool. When I think that I am greater than you because I can do something better than you is the thinking of a rich young fool. Because no one in life is greater than anyone else in life based upon what they have. Because everything we have is a gift from God for the sake of all. Amen?
Amen.
And sometimes we get frustrated with each other. We say, well, why can't you do this and why can't you do that? Not everybody can do the same thing. Not everybody can do the same thing. But you know, we can pick on wealth because wealth seems to be easy to pick on. But let's say you think that you've earned your wealth through your hard work or your due diligence, or you got up for at 6 a.m. or 4 a.m. in the morning for the last 30 years. Listen, your wealth is only there because God said so. And if you think that you're greater than anybody else because of your wealth, the one that thinks that I am greater is the rich young fool. You're a fool to think that you're greater than anybody else based upon the things that God has given you. Because naked you came into this world, and naked you shall leave, and everything in between is a gift from God. Yeah. And he'll make you naked again if he has to. He's done it before, and he'll do it again. Remember Nebuchadnezzar? Nebuchadnezzar, good example. He ruled the world. And one day he got out and he looked at his great empire and he said, I am the King of Kings and I am the Lord of Lords and I have acquired all this. And it said he was struck down in a moment. He became like a beast, like a fool, it says. He was insane. He babbled. His hair grew and his nails grew and he lived in the forest and he ate grass. Wow. Nebuchadnezzar, ruler of the world, because he thought that he acquired it of himself. Every gift and resource. I don't know what your gift is, but we all have lots of gifts in life. We all have certain strengths and weaknesses. To think that you are greater than anybody in this life at any time is the thinking of the rich young fool. Nobody is greater than anybody else based upon what they have, because everybody has something different. Amen?
Amen.
This is the bigger bonds, or the greater bonds, if you will. But if you look on, I want to maybe expound a little bit in the area where it says rich towards God. And could somebody read, who has not read before, somebody read verse 20 for us again?
But God said to him, fool, this night your soul will be required of you. Then whose will those things be which you have provided?
Yeah, that's great, Helen. So God said to him, fool, and read that last sentence also, Helen. Excellent. And there at the very bottom it says, so he who lays up treasure for himself and is not, so is he who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God. So my question is, what does it mean to be rich towards God? What does it mean to be rich towards God? Now, some of us, when we think about this, you know, we're not supposed to store up treasures down here. We're supposed to store up treasures in heaven. Let me tell you what, first of all, rich towards God does not mean. It does not mean what half of us have thought for most of our lifetime, meaning that we're supposed to store up a certain amount of wealth in heaven. When I go to heaven, I'm going to have me a nice gold crown. When I go to heaven, I'm going to have me a mansion. When I go to heaven, I'm going to have all kinds of treasures, because Scripture says, don't store up treasures on earth, but store them up in heaven, as if God doesn't condone greed on earth, but he does condone it in heaven. Right? Now, that's not what it means, to lay up for yourself treasures in heaven. God doesn't condone greed in heaven. If he rebukes the young fool for storing up wealth on earth, what do you think? He condones it in heaven? No, it's also condemned to store it. It's impossible to store it up in heaven also. But altogether, with our natural thinking, you know, we can't have our wealth down here, so I'll have it up there, you know? And we like to hold on to a certain thing that heaven promises us in a natural way because we're carnally minded, because there's certain things in life that we want, right? And we think about the treasures that we have for us in heaven, and we say, well, my life will flash before the screen in heaven, but I'll be left with gold and silver and crowns and jewels, and that's not really what it's talking about. Because God doesn't condone a certain amount of greed in heaven either, right? So that's not what it's talking about. God is not transferring our greed to another area. And I think the primary thought is this: anytime that we think we're storing up something for ourselves, I want to quote unquote the word ourselves, anything that we have in our life when we think it's for us is where the pitfall comes. Anything you have in your life is not for you, it is for you to give away. Amen. Thanks, Pastor Dad. That's the only reason why God has given you a certain abundance of anything in life. He gave it to you to give away. It's not to store it up for yourselves, to big, bigger bonds for yourself, if you will, to amass and say, look what I have acquired, you've acquired nothing. And the only reason why you have abundance of a certain amount of resource, it's to give it to somebody. The only reason why you have a certain talent is to bless somebody with it. The only reason why you can sing is to comfort someone. The only reason why you're good at math is to put somebody on the moon. The only reason why you have a certain amount of riches is to go bless everybody. It's not for you to make sure that you're healthy and wealthy when you're 70 years old, when you got poor people living all around you today. Does anybody want to say amen?
Amen.
Does anybody want to say amen? Yeah. Uh-huh. We'll walk around the needs across all of our life and we'll say, no, this is for the rainy day, as if it's not raining all around us, everybody. It's raining all around us because our trust is in our wealth, and we are not storing up our treasures in heaven. Because if we realize that the heavens are all around us, we're going to take all of our resources and I'm going to store up my treasure in heaven. What does that mean? I'm going to give it to you. I'm going to give all my resources to you. And that's the heaven in which I store up my wealth. You are the heavens in which I store up my wealth. I give you my love. I give you my forgiveness. I give you truth. I give you honesty. I give you kindness. Somebody in the house? Yeah, yeah. Give it out. Give it away. I believe scripture says, freely you have received, freely give. Freely you have received, number one and primary, freely you have received the love of God. Man, don't be so stingy with that stuff, everybody. Don't be so stingy with the love, determining who gets it and who doesn't get it and how much they get. Oh, you know that's the truth. Yeah. How about forgiveness? Love and forgiveness. My goodness, as if you and I have any right to say, oh, I'll forgive and never forget. What foolish, you rich young fool to say I don't forgive you. You rich young fool to say I forgive but don't forget. You rich young fool, scripture says. Your soul is required of you this day, right? As if you have not received all of heaven already. As if you have not received the greatest gift of all, which is forgiveness. Forgiveness, right? As if that's for you only, as if that's for you only, as if love is for you only, as if kindness is for you only. I mean, we can go on to some of these, you know, material elements or talents, but how about just kindness and goodness and gentleness, right? How about giving someone the benefit of the doubt and not counting their wrongs against them? Yeah, yeah, yeah. How about storing up for yourselves riches in heaven where neither moth nor rust does corrupt, amen. Yeah, sure. You see, the storing up the treasure, the rebuke is that, you see, whatever you have in life, it's for the purpose of giving it away. It's not for you to make sure you have more than enough for yourself. And I know that's not the thinking that goes on in America, nor in the world by and large. We want to store up enough for us to take care of us and our children's children, when there's needs all around us. And God says, you rich young fool. You rich young fool. Isn't that interesting? And nobody thinks so. Nope, no preacher. You keep selling, but I ain't buying. Nope. I'm telling you no. Be that as it may. I'm just playing with you. So let's take a look at Matthew chapter 6. Let's read this one. Brother Keith, if you got that. I don't think this one's in your notes. Matthew chapter 6, verses 19. This is an addendum since we were in here last week. And verses 19 through 21, who has not read before? Somebody read that out for us, would you? It's on your screen, go ahead.
Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys, where thieves do not break in and steal.
Good.
For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also.
Excellent. Excellent. Anybody know that verse? Yeah. Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. It says, don't lay up for yourselves treasures on the earth where moth does eat them and rust does consume them, where thieves can break in and steal them, but lay them up in heaven, right? And you see, do you know the moth and the rust that this scripture is speaking of, and the thief, if you will, it's you. When we think that all of the riches of heaven, because the moth and the rust is something that consumes the riches, you know, it eats it up. When you consume the riches of this life just for yourself, you are both the moth and the rust, and you are the thief, if you will, to think that all of the riches in life that God has given you is just for you. You are the thief that steals the riches from all of creation. Isn't that interesting? Because you store it up on earth, saying it's just stored up for me. My wealth is for me, whatever it might be. Whatever it might be. I'm not just talking about physical wealth, but it seems like that one always hits home, and maybe you can let that bleed out into all your other treasures in life. But it says, our treasures are not for us to consume. This truth alone can transform our lives. This truth alone. Because it comes against everything that we want, or it comes against our lives, if you will, right? Scripture says, if you take your wealth and consume it upon yourself only, you are the one who is the rich young fool. You're the rust, if you will. You're the moth, if you will. At the very end, you are the thief in life who has stolen from all of mankind because you consume your wealth only for yourself. As if God has given you anything for you, rather he gave it for you to dispense. That is the reason why you have a certain abundance of something. It is to dispense. For where your heart is, there your treasure is also. If you give it away, your heart is with everybody. It's with the body of Christ, really. If you store it unto yourself, it's just a life unto yourself. And you know, that's not the lives that we live, or at least we don't profess to live that with our own mouths. You know? And how about this? All aboard so far? Not really, preacher, but anyway. You see, how about the manna theory, right? Does anybody remember the manna that rained down from heaven for like 40 years, man? 40 years. You remember the story, everybody? The Israelites, the only food they would get was the manna that rained from heaven every morning. I can't even imagine that still today. Manna, food came from heaven. It rained from heaven every day. They were supposed to go out and get their manna for the day. For how long? For the day. What happens if they got it for 2 days? It would rot. It would rot. How about that? Live off of that one. Everything you got today, give it all away today. Because if you leave it over for tomorrow, it's rotten. Anytime you say, I'm not going to bless you today or help you today because I have a certain need tomorrow, it's rotten. It's ungodly. It's the rich young fool. But that's not the way we think as Americans. That's not the way we think as civilized people. What are you talking about? Interesting, isn't it? Yet these concepts and these truths are all throughout the Bible. He says, just take enough for today. Just take enough for today. If you hold on to something for tomorrow, it's rotten. It's rotten. When there are needs all around us, and we're holding on to something because we have something to do tomorrow. Because I got a bill tomorrow. I got a need tomorrow. I got a party tomorrow. Sometimes it's not a bill. Sometimes it's a party. I got a party tomorrow. And we're the thief, the rich young fool. And it says, you fool. You're a fool. You're amassing that for what? That could all be gone from you tomorrow. Anybody experience that stuff? Right, yeah. That stuff that you're saving for tomorrow? Huh. It might not even be there tomorrow. Right. You might not even be here tomorrow. And God wants to set us free from this anxiety that we have and we say we don't have. From this trusting in riches that we say we have or we don't have, but maybe we do have a certain trusting in riches. And any of you who have been without in life, you know, anybody ever been without in life? Any of you have ever been without finances or resources? Anybody ever had like a car taken or a house taken or a power or water shut off? Everybody in the house, right? You know what happens? You know what happens sometimes with our thinking? When you ever get, I mean, hopefully you've all experienced a time in life where you had like a little extra and you get extra money and all of a sudden what you want to do is you want to put it away because you know that they might shut my power off tomorrow, right? You ever finally been broke forever and you finally get a little money and you don't want to do anything to spend it, right? And you're squeezing it and squeezing those dollars out and I'm not letting it go this time. and it goes anyway. But God wants to build your faith in him and not in your faith in riches. And whether you get it all today, he says, give it all away. Give it all away. Don't worry about tomorrow. God's word is still the same. Whether you've experienced hard times or not, he says, don't worry about tomorrow. Seems like the harder you hold on to it, the poorer you are. In your mind, you are poor because you're holding on to something that you're afraid you're going to lose. So I'd like to buy you a pack of gum today, or I'd like to buy you a lunch today, but these dollars are tight. I'm not buying you your lunch today. Whatever it is in life. God gives us a certain amount of wealth to give away. Right? Right, everybody? Doesn't it say that time and time again? It says there, it says, store it up in heaven. Store it up in heaven. Because if you keep it unto yourself, you are the moth, you are the rust, and you are the thief that's stealing all of your treasures from all of mankind. He says, store it up in heaven. Give it away. Give it away. Give what away? Give your time away. Give your love away. Give your kindness away. Give your talents away. Do you have a certain talent at something? You know, does anybody have any talents in the house, whether you go to computers or painting or arts and crafts or sewing? You know, give it away. There are needs all around you. Give it away. You have this gift to give freely. You have received. Why do you think you have these gifts? Give them away, right? That's what God tells us to do. Don't store it up unto yourself. God is showing us not to be the rich fool, to find out how we become rich in this life. And God is saying, I'm going to tell you how to become rich in this life. So what are the treasures? You know, it says store up treasures in heaven. You know, the treasures that are in heaven, you know, the treasures of heaven are love. You know, even certain scripture says the treasures of heaven is knowledge. Knowledge is treasure. A wise man stores up knowledge, scripture says. And even love is perhaps the greatest treasure of heaven. And you know, the interesting thing about love, when scripture speaks of wealth, there's no greater wealth in heaven than love itself. Love is the greatest treasure in heaven and on earth. And the interesting thing about love is that part is written in your notes. If you look at page 1 and the very bottom part of your page, it says, the only treasure worth anything in heaven, if you're going to store up treasure in heaven, the only treasure worth anything is love. Now look at the rest of this. By definition, love, it says, it is not self-seeking. Love is not self-seeking. So love cannot store up anything for itself then. In other words, it consists, in fact, in the opposite movement, not storing up, but giving away. The wealth is self-giving and self-emptying. The only wealth that you and I could ever have in heaven is an act of constantly giving of yourself and emptying of yourself. A self-giving and a self-emptying. This is true riches. Whatever it is in life, whatever you have in life, it's the self-giving and self-emptying that makes you wealthy. Amen? Yeah, yeah, sure. Sure. Maybe we can turn to another passage. Maybe we can take a look at Matthew chapter 19. Look at this, everybody. We have another rich young ruler here. Brother Keith will help us out. There you go. Thank you. Matthew chapter 19, verses 16 through 22. Who has not read? Would somebody read what's on the screen for us?
Now behold, one came and said to him, good teacher, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life? So he said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good but one, that is God. But if you want to enter into life, keep the commandments. He said to him, which ones? Jesus said, you shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness. Honor your father and your mother, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. The young man said to him, all these things I have kept from my youth, but what do I still lack? Jesus said to him, if you want to be perfect, go, sell what you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. But when the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions.
Something, huh? Something. What do I do to get eternal life? Bottom line was this: sell what you have and give it to the poor. What was it, what did the rich young fool do? He went away sorrowful because he had some stuff and he wanted to hold on to his stuff. He didn't realize that the only reason why he had it was to give away. God gave it to him to give away. I want you to be released by this truth. Whatever God has given to you, he's given it to you to give away. And what's going to happen in turn is he's going to continually give to you to give away. It's not like it's a one-shot deal. It's a life that's lived. Amen. Amen? Your richness comes in giving away what you have, and you become richer and richer by the self-giving and self-emptying. Once you give everything away, he'll constantly renew you and restore you, and you'll be a constant flow. You see, this rich young man went away sorrowful because he wasn't willing to give what he had. He wanted to live to himself and take care of himself and make sure that he was fine. And he was willing to let go of eternal life. He was willing to let go of eternal life for temporary riches. And we say rich young fool, but yet we live as the rich young fool. Because we don't trust in God sometimes as much as we trust in riches. Sometimes we are very happy when I got that $300, $200 in the bank. You know, that makes me happy, right? Everybody, oh, I'm happy when I got some bucks in the bank, right? Everybody happy when you got bucks in the bank? Yeah, you don't even want to talk to me, do you? When I don't have any money in the bank and any money in my pocket, I'm not happy. I know. Although you're not admitting it, I know. But you see, God is changing the way we think. Yes. And he's causing you to trust in him. You see, and God calls us to be self-emptying and self-giving. Give of yourself. We don't understand this mystery of the kingdom. If you give out and give away, he will replenish you, and you will continually give out and give away. Give it away and stop holding on to it and stop planning for tomorrow. He's going to set you free from the anxieties and the trust in riches that we all have. He will set us free because he says, rich young fool, he says, you fool, your soul is required of you this night, and what you have stored up for you and yours, now you don't even know who's going to get it. Isn't that something? But I want you to see the encouragement here. This young fool that walked away too, because the young man is going to go away and the fool is going to go away. We are the fool and the young man that's going to go away. Our soul will be required of us, and God is going to change us. He's going to turn us from the fool into the wise man. He's going to turn us into the young man to the mature man, if you will. He's going to cause the change in our life. That's what he says. He says, your soul is required of you. And even as we hear these words of truth and life, he says, your soul is required of you this night, where he will change you. He will change the way you think. He will change what you trust in. And we will start to live a life, God intended, to give ourselves away, to give all the riches that God has given to us, knowing the only reason why we have anything in this life is to give it away. The soul of the fool is required of him, and now there is a conversion, a transformation. And we will release the things that God has put into our lives, right? Yeah. And then, you know, I'll just end with the most powerful illustration of all, I think. And it's the story of the poor widow. Everybody, I think, by a show of hands, knows the story of the poor widow who put in two mites into the offering. Remember the poor widow who put two pennies into the offering? Yes, that's right. Yeah, you know, look at that passage there in Luke chapter 12, verses 41 through 44. Is it in your notes there? Look again, maybe it's there. Luke 12, 41, look again, Brother Keith. We got, there you go. I knew it was there. Who has not read? Would somebody read this story to us?
No master puts in charge of his servant to give them their food allowance at the proper time. It will be good for that servant whom the master finds doing so when he returns. Truly, I tell you, he will put him in charge of all his possessions.
Yeah, that's not it. Let's see the story of the rich young widow. Who has a Bible? Anybody know where that account is? Let me get my Bible here. I'd like to read that. There we go. That was my fault. I gave Brother Keith the wrong passage there. If you find it before I do, just shout out the location. Poor widow. It's Luke 21. I inverted those numbers. Are you able to pull it up, Keith? Okay, great, thanks. Yeah, I inverted the numbers. No, it ain't Luke 21. Yeah, it is. It's the beginning of it, okay. Yeah, I don't know what those numbers are. Okay, Luke 21, verse 1. I could read it unless you have it. Okay, great. Brother Mark, why don't you pick it up from there?
As Jesus looked up, he saw the rich putting their gifts into the temple treasury. He also saw a poor widow put in two very small copper coins. Truly I tell you, he said, this poor widow has put in more than all the others. All these people gained their gift out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in all she had to live on.
That is perfect. Thank you, brother. That's it. I want to close with this parable of, or this account of the poor widow. In regard to, I don't know, does anybody have a certain something coming up in the near future that they're looking to get paid for? You know, sometimes you're trying to get your mortgage paid for, you're trying to get your electric paid for. Maybe you got a vacation coming up that you're trying to save for, or a birthday or something, you know. There's always something in our future, and we're always a little bit concerned about how we're going to take care of the future. And sometimes in our concern for the future, we lay up our treasures in earth rather than in heaven, and we become stingy with the treasures that are already in our possession because we are not trusting in God. Can you guys see that? Because we're trusting in our riches rather than trusting in God. But I want you to know how great your God is. I want you to know how much he loves you. And he will take care of your tomorrows. He will take care of your tomorrows. If you will put your riches and store them up in heaven, you will see your tomorrows are more than paid for. And God encourages us not to live for ourselves. We're constantly encouraged not to live for ourselves. I remember one time, and I'm sure all of us have a dozen stories to share, but I remember one time, you know, we all deal with money issues. There was one time when I didn't have very much money, and all of a sudden I got $200. And with that $200, you know, I was like, oh, I'm going to squeeze this one pretty tight, let it last for a while. And someone came to me, and they had an electric bill to pay, and it was right around $200, of course. But the Lord shared in that moment, he said, the only reason why I gave you that $200 was to pay their electric bill. Isn't that something? Isn't that something? And I'm sure all of you have stories just like that. You see, God gives you treasures to give away. What about you? He's got you, man. He'll cause 10 other people to come your way and take care of you, okay? Does anybody believe that? God will give you things that are not for you. They're to give away. He does not want you to trust in your riches. He does not want you to look at tomorrow, but he wants you to trust in him. And some of these points here, in a world that continually amasses treasures for itself, this widow gave it all away. In a world that continually amasses treasures for itself, we are encouraged to give it all away. Interesting? And this poor widow, without knowing it or without knowing it, Without knowing it or without even caring to know it, she was rich towards God. She didn't do it to become rich towards God. It's like I'm doing this, so I'll have treasures in heaven. It was her heart to give. Without even knowing that that caused her to be rich towards God. She gave away. She didn't give away because, you know, sometimes we say, oh, I'm putting my $2 in the box. No, it wasn't that she gave $2 or 2 pennies. She gave everything she had because so many times I get $2 offerings on a Sunday. It's not the two that's magical. It's magical if that's everything that you have. She gave everything that she had. Without even caring or thinking about riches in heaven. Something, huh? And the lesson is, it's do not be anxious for tomorrow. Do not be anxious for tomorrow. God will take care of your tomorrow. Without even wondering how she would find a meal for tomorrow, she gave everything that she had today. Without even a thought about her meal tomorrow, she gave everything that she had today. She didn't even feel what she did involved a risk. And so many of us are just so young, and we say, oh, I'm giving this offering in faith that this $15 will become $15 million. Nonsense. I'm giving my 15, so I'll get 15, whatever. Nonsense. This woman gave everything that she had without even thinking there was a risk involved. She gave everything that she had knowing that God was fully able to take care of her tomorrow. Wow, can we live like that? Should we live like that? God will change. He says, fool, your soul's required of you this night. God is going to change the way you think, change the way you live, and change the way you act. He's going to change the way you think about tomorrow. Without even thinking that it was a risk to give away her resources. Without even thinking that it was a risk. She gave it away. And sometimes, you know, when you give, you start to give, you say, oh, maybe I shouldn't have given. You can never make a mistake in giving. Can never make a mistake in giving. God will take care of you. Even less that it was, she didn't think it was a challenge for God to look after her tomorrow. It was no challenge for God to take care of her tomorrow. I'll take care of everybody around me today. Tomorrow will take care of itself. It's no challenge for God. Amen. You know, let me close with this one proverb, and maybe you have it for us, Brother Keith. I'm going to close with this one proverb, and it's found Proverbs 11, verses 24 and 25. Look at this. It says, one person gives freely, yet gains even more. Another withholds unduly, and we'll stop there for a moment, but comes to poverty. You see, to be rich is to give. You're not rich because you have a lot. You're rich because you give. What makes a rich person rich is the fact that they give. It says the one person who freely gives yet gains even more. That's how you become wealthy in life. Give away everything that you have. Oh, okay, preacher. Well, God will take you to wherever he can, but give it all away. And then another withholds unduly. And the one who holds on to what they have, you never have enough, and you come to poverty. God encourages you to give away and to bless people around you. He says, store up your treasures in heaven where neither rust nor moth, where you can't get a hold of it, man. It's not for you. Remember when Jesus was about to ascend on high and he said, all power has been given to me, both in the earth and in heaven. How about that? He says, all power is given to me. Jesus had all of the power of heaven and earth. And then what did he do after that? And then he just gave it all away. He says, go ye therefore. He says, I give you all of the power that I have. Everything that you have, the reason that you have it is to give it. It's not because you're greater than anybody around you. You have a certain something to give. Give it. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Why don't you all stand, everybody? Praise the Lord. And who can close us with a word of prayer, please?